Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the Pittsburgh Conference Achievement Awards Symposium. And this symposium is in the honor of the recipient of the Pittsburgh Conference Achievement Award. The award is co-sponsored by the Pittsburgh Conference and the Society for Analytical Chemists of Pittsburgh, or SACP. This award is presented annually at the Pittsburgh Conference and to recognize individuals with outstanding achievement and or in analytical chemistry or applied spectroscopy within 10 years of after they finish their PhD work. And the 2014 awardee goes to Dr. Sarah Trimpin. Dr. Trimpin has done tremendous work, especially in mass spectrometry. And she is a professor at Wayne State University in Detroit, Michigan. And this award comes with a plaque and a modest honorarium. And the award is presented, or was supposed to be presented by Dr. James Manner. Unfortunately, Dr. Manner passed away a few months ago, and the award is being presented by the current SACP chairman, Mr. John Vereen. John was the SACP former chairman and also Pittcon 2008 president.
If you want, you can go downstairs too. It's more comfy for you.
You had to read a big file. Well, thank you all for coming. And I would like to start with a few pictures. So Fred McLeverty, he was my first exposure to mass spectrometry, where I had to push, where I had to push arrows for the Fred McLeverty. And I was very impressed, and you can imagine how thrilled I was when he agreed to speak in this session. The good and the bad news is that he is doing well after having suffered a stroke. So he's not gonna be here today, but we found somebody that will speak in his behalf. Another person that has impressed me and has helped me, guide me, being a better scientist, is John Fenn. When he came out to Oregon, I was his personal chauffeur for about a week, where we had very nice conversations during the car ride. There are many other people that I would like to thank, and I would like to acknowledge, that have somehow contributed in my development. And of course, the heart of all the people is my PhD advisor and my postdoc advisor. So Hans-Joachim Reder taught me how to think outside of the box, and David Klemmer taught me how to use that knowledge to be academically successful. So thank you. There are many other people that I would like to acknowledge that have worked in the field of ionization. And when I left David Klemmer's group, I had this vision to do atmospheric pressure MALDI, because there are so many things that you can do at atmospheric pressure. And my idea was very similar to L. Burlingame's and Arcos Verdi's work. So that's where I will start with my talk. So the idea was that AP MALDI has a lot of benefits, but there are also drawbacks. The benefit is that you work at atmospheric pressure, you shoot the laser from the front, but it's relatively quite a distance to the mass spectrometer inlet because you have to align the laser from the front. You apply a voltage so that the ions that are created here get somehow into the mass spectrometer inlet. Will it be modeled that 99% of ions can be lost, so they will never find entrance of the mass spectrometer inlet. So there's plenty of room for improvements. So what I propose to do is to use the laser just in transmission geometry, so we would have to have a transmitting plate, for example, a glass plate. We would ablate all the material, so the matrix and the analyte, and push it into the mass spectrometer, so we don't need to have this detrimental voltage. The idea was that we could have a very focused laser, so we could have nice improvements in spatial resolution for imaging. This is shown here. The important part is that this experiment worked within less than 30 minutes. It worked, so on an orbitrap mass spectrometer, because I did not have an own instrument. But we started with lipids, and we saw the single charge ions. We were really excited because this approach worked so readily. What we didn't expect is when we moved to the peptides that we saw doubly charged ions, just like ESI. And I was convinced we're doing something wrong, but it was right. We had to learn what made the multiple charged ions so that we were able to see lysozyme with a laser, with a matrix, just like a MALDI experiment, but we see the charge states just like ESI. And so because we used the orbitrap mass spectrometer, we saw also the isotopic distributions. Don Hunt allowed us to come to his lab where we run the first LSI ETD experiments. So we used the ubiquitin charge state 11 for that. So this is a mass spectrum, 100 millisecond acquisitions are rather fast. We select the charge state 11 and a single acquisition, so also 100 millisecond, we get a very data information rich set, but we were unable to characterize it. In order to analyze the data set, we had to slow the entire process down to about 40 seconds because we incorporated proton transfer reaction. By doing so, we were able to actually analyze the sequence, and it was very comparable with electrospray ionization. What we need for laser spray, so to observe the multiple charge ions, is shown here. You can come in transmission geometry. You can come in reflection geometry. It doesn't matter. It's irrelevant. It's just much more convenient to come in transmission geometry because of the laser alignment. Because the only thing that you have to do is you focus the laser onto the glass plate, and that's it. The material then falls into the mass spectrometer inlet. What you need is a heated inlet and a pressure drop to create the ions. So this boils down then to the ion source, this inlet. And when you ablate the material, instead of pushing it into the mass spectrometer, you collect it on a glass plate, you see the liquefied droplets just by the impact of the laser. And this was modeled for vacuum MALDI by Barbara Gerson in the 90s. The other data set here shows the importance of the heat. So if you are at 150 degrees Celsius of the heat in the inlet, you are well below 1,000 ion counts. If you increase the temperature to 350 degrees Celsius, you all of a sudden have astonishing ion abundance of 50,000 for the multiple charged ions. So the heat and the pressure drop are very important to create the analyte ions. So operationally, it is like MALDI, because you use a matrix and you use a laser. But the ionization is ESI-like. So you have clusters, they are charged, and what you have to do is you have to get rid of the matrix to then observe the multiple charged ions. We tried many things to understand the fundamentals of this new ionization method, and we just went through this one, all right? But in fact, we don't need a laser at all. We can use a BB gun or we can use a glass plate and just tap it against the inlet. We, in fact, don't even need the organic matrix. We can just use a solution. We connect the solution with the analyte with a few silica tube with the inlet of the mass spectrometer where you have a hot spot to create the ions. This was done by our collaborator's lab, Chuck McCune. Inlet ionization is governed by one and the same thing. You need the heated inlet and you need the pressure drop. Our group was working at the same time on vacuum ionization. And you can read the scheme vertically or horizontally. So you can also read it laser spray ionization in the inlet or in the vacuum. And I will cover all aspects a little bit in this talk. The first part I will talk about inlet ionization. This is the solvent introduction method, where we just squirt the liquid into the mass spectrometer. Here you can see it a little better. The temperature is around 250 in general, and we don't want to touch the polymer, so the pipette tip, against the inlet, just to avoid any problems. But by doing so, we can, for example, analyze this phosphopeptide mixture in the positive mode and in the negative mode. So it's rather soft because we don't have any fragmentation. We can just align a multi-channel pipette tip that is mounted on the XYZ stage. So align it with the inlet of the mass spectrometer and then move it with the XYZ stage. This is a movie showing the operation. I guess not. This computer is not working. We had already a lot of problems this morning with this computer, with this setup, so we're trying again. So the pipette tips are filled, aligned with the inlet. The inlet pushes, draws it into the vacuum where the ionization occurs in the inlet. So they had to restart the other computer many times, and then they brought this one. I hope this one is going to hold for the session. So by doing so, we can also multiplex to 96 well-plate approach. We can just put the pipette tips into the filled vials here. They're drawn into the pipette tip, and then we just align the entire array. By doing so, we can analyze 42 samples in less than 5 minutes. This is the total ion current up here for the different samples. We use one and the same temperature, and here's shown for a variety of different samples, the clozapine to leucophyllin, sphingomyelin, all the way to lysozyme. So using the same temperature, we can analyze rather quickly a variety of different samples. So now the fundamental aspects a little bit. So we see ions. They come from the solid or from a liquid phase, and they go into the gas phase. There's no doubt about that because we see that in the mass spectrum. It cannot be a gas phase chemical ionization mechanism, and the ions cannot be pre-charged because it would be prohibitive to lift them from the surface. However, what we see is ESI-like mass spectra. From ESI, we know that field evaporation or charge residue model is discussed. So therefore, we must hypothesize that our ionization method is based on a charged particle mechanism. However, how do we obtain those charged droplets with absent voltage? We hypothesize following. So it doesn't matter if we now have a liquid droplet or a solid matrix. They enter the inlet of the mass spectrometer where the charges occur. Through the heated inlet, that there's supercharging and very likely also collisions with the surface, and the pressure drop that helps guiding them, the particles through the inlet. This is not unexpected. If you go into the literature, George Ewing and Martin Sherwood showed for a liquid introduction method that you can have the charge creation of many elementary charges, so millions, just, and he described this as electrification method. And important is that he describes the positively and the negatively charged ions, exactly what we see with inlet ionization as well. Marvin Vestal already showed in discussed actually in 1983, so prior to MALDI and ESI, that there's a common mechanism. And he envisioned also that it's from a solid or liquid phase. And he envisioned that it comes through clusters and that the evaporation process is important. And he also envisioned the ESI process there. David Russell described in the 90s that there are also charged particles delayed in the MALDI process. So we believe that this is perhaps one of the first examples of the cluster mechanism. More recently, Zanobi showed that clusters are formed. He used the DESI, LSI, and AP MALDI approach, that in all three processes, clusters are involved. So lessons from ESI and inlet ionization is that it requires to desolvate those charged droplets, and very likely those desolvation must be important in MALDI as well. So what I have shown you is inlet ionization using a mass spectrometer that is commercially available with the inlet. There are many mass spectrometers that don't have inlet, just like the skimmer cone of the Waters instruments. We showed the proof of principle that we can build our own inlet and get the LSI ions. But they were not analytically useful. More recently, Alan Marshall showed that he can use, by building an inlet on his FDICR, that he gets just like he would get with ESI. So this is ubiquitin, and he used the CID to do the fragmentation. So there's promise. If there are, the thought was that if there are clusters, we have to decluster easier. If there's no heat, well, we have to find matrices that evaporate easier from those clusters. And so we went ahead and investigated many different compounds to test if they are available in ionization for the analyte ions. And here shown is the 450 degrees Celsius on the LDQ values. So we can use, for example, the succinic acid for the analyte ionization of the bovine insulin. We can use anthracene. We can use this compound as well. We can even use this compound at 50 degrees Celsius, but it does not perform well. It's only E to the 2. This compound, this 3-NBN3-nitrobenzonitrile, works very well at 50 degrees Celsius and has a very nice iron abundance. So this may be actually analytically useful. So in summary, for this set of experimenters, we analyzed over 200 matrices that worked at 450 degrees Celsius. We cannot distinguish their performance. However, if we go at medium pressure, fewer matrices worked. And if we are at low temperature, really only one worked that is analytically useful, and this is the 3-NBN, so the 3-nitrobenzonitrile. Now I'd like to talk about the vacuum ionization part of this scheme. There are many other instruments that don't have even any capabilities of heating up, and these are the vacuum MALDI instruments. And the advantage there, we see that we don't have any rim losses, so we have higher sensitivity, just like MALDI. And we would have then the advantages that ESI has of improved fragmentation and improved separation. If we are right, that we are, these are droplets, well, we have to evaporate, so we have to find even more volatile matrix compounds. The good thing about it is that we still have a pressure drop, so from 0.16 torr to the high vacuum of the mass spectrometer. By finding the 2,5-DHAP, we were able to exactly create the same multiple charged ions that you can get at atmospheric pressure using a vacuum MALDI source, intermediate pressure, though. We can use the same spot and produce the multiple charged ions, and we can produce the singly charged ions at will if we use the extraction voltage that comes with the mass spectrometer. If we remove them, we get the laserspray ions. So if the highly charged ions are produced at atmospheric pressure and at intermediate pressure, they must be also formed at high vacuum. So finding even more volatile matrix compounds, the NPG, we are able to analyze, at least to extend the concept of laserspray ionization to vacuum, so to high vacuum. But we don't have the same charge states that we have at intermediate pressure, but they are intact. This is contrary to HCCA. So now I would like to ask a question. What do we really know about ionization? So what you see here is a plate. It has the matrix and the analyte. And this is the IMS dimension, and this is the M over C dimension. So the plate is indexing, and you see ions. It's still indexing, and you see ions. At that point, when it's indexing, we would not be able to use a laser. This process is laser-free, and it is in the vacuum, so it is vacuum-driven. We see 5 seconds indexed. We see that the matrix is still on there, and there must be the analyte incorporated. After 70 seconds, particles have removed. This 3-NBN that we're using for this is known to sublime. It's also known to show triboluminescence. Triboluminescence is if crystals break, this one side keeps the positive charge and the other side keeps the negative charge. There's a charge buildup, and when there's a charge buildup, there's a dinitrogen discharge eventually. So we know that we have 3-NBN. It's important. We also know that we have those crystals. And we know that we have the analyte ions. We hypothesize at this point that the clusters are ripped into the gas phase by the vacuum to form those charged clusters. The analyte goes into the gas phase, and all it needs is to evaporate the matrix so that we have the bare analyte ions. Once we have the ions, we can use the high-performance mass spectrometers and do what we need to do. We analyzed many other compounds that showed sublimation that don't show analyte ionization. We analyzed many matrix compounds that show triboluminescence that didn't show the ionization either, because they were just sitting there as a rock on the plate. So what we believe, it's a sublimation-driven triboluminescence process. The only compound that is known to have triboluminescence and sublimation is coumarin, and it works, but it does not work as well as the 3-NBN. This BSA, 66 kilodalton, on a vacuum MALDI source without the laser, heat, or extraction voltage, will produce 35 charges. Bacteriodiopsin, a membrane protein, tricky with MALDI, tricky with ESI. Using the conditions described by Hopper, we can also analyze now complexes that are not applicable with MALDI. So we have a nice handle on doing complexes directly from surfaces. This is a protein mixture. This shows how we intend to use ion mobility. So this is the ion mobility dimension. So the separation in the gas phase, and this is the M over C separation. And the color plot indicates the different ion intensities. We can assign them. So to the right is the myoglobin. There's the ubiquitin, and there's the lysozyme. This is reproducible enough to use the nested data set described by David Klemmer. And because they are so nicely separated, because we have the multiple charged ions, we now have an instantaneous ionization and instantaneous separation. So where we can pull out all the mass spectra individually. What I believe has potential is that we can put down the 3NMN matrix on a tissue and analyze exactly that area. And here shown is the lipids, the peptides, and the proteins. To the left-hand side is the tissue before we put the matrix down, and to the right-hand side is the tissue after we put the matrix down. So this is the area that we analyzed. We anticipate that we can use this approach for single-cell analyses in the future. I'm coming from Detroit. So here is a $20 bill. We put it exactly on the eye on the right eye of the president, and we put it into the mass spectrometer and analyze the cocaine. We analyze it by MS-MS. So this is also a very sensitive method. So you have the specificity and the sensitivity. Here shown is the comparison with MALDI IMS. So certainly we have separation in the eye mobility, but you will agree you have many more, much better separation because you have the multiple charged ions. This is a BSA digest. For more information, it's covered by Bishi Wang at 9 o'clock this morning. For us, important is, of course, to understand what we can do, but also what is the fundamentals. And here shown is the negative mode measurement of ubiquitin and of beta amyloid. So this is one indication that the triboluminescence may be correct. But it's also important for us because Bowers showed that on amyloid peptides, that the negative mode measurements give much more accurate results than the positive mode measurements. And so here we compare the MAIV with the ESI, and we see exactly the same drift times and the same shapes. So this is indicative that we can use this approach to get cross-sections just like ESI. You saw with your bare eyes that it takes 2 minutes to get the multiplate loaded into the mass spectrometer. So we lose ions for 2 minutes. So this is not analytically useful. What we did, we cooled the plate to minus 80 and then put it into the mass spectrometer. We postponed ionization, as you see on the bottom. And by that, we were able to enhance the sensitivity. But as I said, this is not analytically useful. And all we know that the vacuum is important, so we did another movie. And what you see here, here's the sample and the analyte. We opened the inlet of the skimmer cone very wide. We protect the instrument by this valve here. So we put the clasp plate on the skimmer cone to initiate ionization. This one is working cool. So we put the sample right on top, open the valve, and we see the ions. So this is ionization at vacuum directly from ambient conditions. It doesn't get much easier. So this is the approach. So it hangs off the skimmer cone. We can, for example, analyze the human whole blood extracted from a Band-Aid. We see the alpha and the beta globin chains, and we have the instantaneous ionization too. The result is exactly the same as with the vacuum MALDI source, and we can extract them. Because we don't have any laser, we can analyze very rapidly also the gangliosides with any fragmentation. We can use a nozzle and analyze, for example, nicotine and codeine. So this is the metabolite of nicotine, and there is no chemical background. We can do this rather fast, too, as shown here. We can put it on to a surface, such as this paper, and just put the surface right in front of the mass spectrometer to analyze, in less than 1 minute, 4 samples from small molecules all the way to proteins again, with no cross-contamination. We can use MS-MS, here shown for small molecules. We don't do the selection any longer, so we have all the fragmentation. Because we incorporate the ion mobility, we have all the fragmentation. We can extract the data set afterwards. this is a problem still, but we are getting there. So this is the ETD on the Synapse 2. We can analyze the ETD, but we are limited right at the moment because there's some competition between the ETD reagent gas and the 3-MBN with the galenine. But we can do it. So back to the fundamentals. So what we believe is that we have a matrix with the analyte. These are crystals. When we put it into the vacuum, they start to crack. So this is the initiation of the triboluminescence. And the triboluminescence mechanism provides the charge. The next step would be that the matrix sublimes, so there's concentration, and eventually you have the Bayer ions just like in ESI. So, of course, triboluminescence, that's far from what we have thought in the past. So we can ask many questions, and I'm happy to hear also your questions and possible suggestions. So we can use binary matrices. So we can use 3-MBN, 20% and 80% THC, a common MALDI matrix. It sublimes for 3 minutes. We get beautiful spectra. And when, after everything is sublimed and we use the laser, we don't see anything any longer. So it's a rather harsh process too. So everything goes into the gas phase. We can put 1 mole of sodium chloride into the ubiquitin solution, and the main intensity is still the protonated peak. It's not affected just like as ESI or MALDI is. So we don't have the overwhelming problems that those previous ionization methods have with salt. Because of the insensitivity to salt, we can analyze urine, here shown with allergy drug, with MS on the top and MSMS on the bottom. Samples that need salt, we can analyze. So that's good news, too. As long as there's no competition, we can analyze polymers. pH, we thought might be important. You see here, pH 1, pH 10. They all work, but it really likes just to be around the neutral pH, the natural, without adding anything. Other compounds now work, too, using the ESI source. So here's the amine functionality. Still works, not as pretty. We converted a 2,5 DHB analog, so a MALDI matrix, so it's more volatile, and it produces the MALDI Bajaj ions. We can use Bronopol, and we can analyze angiotensin. It has a very nice ion abundance, but it has also those additional chemical reactions that we still try to understand. We can use this approach using our best-performing matrix, 3-MBN, and analyze gels that we cut out, gel sections. We just put it onto the blade, put the mesh on top, put the matrix onto that gel section, and we see that the matrix pulls out stuff from the gel. We put that into the mass spectrometer and analyze lysozyme and myoglobin, and this is how the picture looks like after it is sublimed and analyzed. There are many matrix compounds that we discovered that work. None of them work as well as the 3-MBN. All the results so far don't have any problems with the triboluminescence, but there are many other nuances that we have to investigate. So we have converted very efficiently molecules to ions at atmospheric pressure and at vacuum. The ionization mechanism is unprecedented, and it is heat or vacuum assisted. But certainly there are many ways to shake off those matrix molecules from the clusters. The methods are fast, flexible, and sensitive, and we can use that with the traditional characterization methods. And we certainly only scratch the surface, especially with the last ionization method. We need to do many, many more experiments. I would like to thank all the people and the collaborators and the funding agencies that helped us to make this work possible, and I'm extremely pleased to receive the Pittcon Achievement Award. It means a lot to me, so thank you. But I wouldn't be here without the help of my dedicated students, and I would really like to acknowledge Ellen Inutan and Bishi Wang. Ellen and Bishi Wang, these are the most senior graduate students, and they pushed with me through thick and thin. So thank you for your attention.